Hi, we welcome you again to our program this evening. We hope that you've been learning a lot with these presentations that we've been having on country living. And we hope that not only this is going to be helpful for you, but also you'll be able to help other people who would want to go to the country. So today we're going to continue with a very important topic. Many people, they want to go to the country, or they are in the country, but they might not know how to plant, especially plant fruits or maybe vegetables. Well, we're going to touch point that is very important today, so we hope that you will enjoy it. Now, before we move on, I'd like to please ask you to join me in a prayer. Our dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this other moment that we have in order for us to learn and know what we need to do when we are in the country. We ask you to please bless this presentation and bless the person who's going to share your word. And we ask you to please impress our minds so that we may understand everything we need to understand. Guide us, Lord, and bless each and everyone who's going to be watching. We pray in the name and merits of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Now, before we consider our presentation for today, we are going to have a special item that's going to be presented by The Last Messengers. And the title of the song is How Great Thou Art.
Thank you.
prepare our hearts to receive the message that we have for this evening. And this message is going to be presented to us by Sister Pam Stemler. And the title of the message is Cultivating Small Fruits.
Welcome back to our presentation on Gardening Basics. In this session, we're going to be discussing cultivating small fruits and vegetables. In our previous sessions, we learned a little bit about the basic principles of gardening, having a place to grow, and how to actually grow your food. Before we discuss more specifics about how to grow small fruits and vegetables, I would like our minds to focus on what the Lord promises for us about the seed of His word in our hearts. For without seeking first His kingdom and His righteousness, our gardening is in vain. We do not want to be fruitless in the spiritual or the physical. From Isaiah 61:11, "For as the earth brings forth her bud, and as the garden causes the things that are sown in it to spring forth, so the Lord God will cause righteousness and praise to spring forth before all nations." We must guard against being so busy that we do not spend the time with the Lord and wait upon Him for His strength and instruction. From the book Gospel Workers, page 272, paragraph 2, "Commune with your own heart and then commune with God. Unless you do this, your efforts will be fruitless, made thus by unsanctified hurry and confusion." So we want to learn from Jesus. Whenever it was His privilege, He turned aside from the scene of His labor and responsibility to go into the field, to wander by the lakeside, to meditate in the green valleys, to hold communion with God on the mountainside or amid the trees of the forest. He would return to His home to take up again the humble duties and to give an example of patient labor. Signs of the Time, August 6, 1896, paragraph 5. Keeping that in mind, we can learn in the garden too. So how? First, I want to apologize for any inconvenience that the sound has made to you. We don't have very stable internet connection here, so it gives us some grief at times. I hope you'll be able to understand. We have a saying here called simpler yet. There are many, many ways to garden with varying results based on your location, your climate, your needs, your effort. Here we've had very large gardens, up to 3 acres, and much smaller gardens. I like things simple, yet they need to be effective and efficient. It is important to note that every type of plant has different requirements and needs for growing, much like us as individuals have differing needs. There are some basic principles that cover them all, which we've already reviewed. All plants need nutrition, sunshine, moisture, and space. How can we know exactly what the different needs are for each plant? It would take too long for me to describe them, but that's why seed catalogs have descriptions and guidelines for every plant they sell. If you pick up packages of seed, they will tell you when to plant, how deep to plant, how far apart, and the number of days to maturity. That keeps it simple. And if you take that information and plan your garden, as was mentioned in the previous session, it shouldn't be too complicated. Again, that's where the handbook comes in. You can refer back to the sections that you need and have a reminder. I need to refer to it every year. Remember that whenever we do anything new to us, it is always a challenge. But as we experience and experiment, we become more familiar with what we are doing. A longtime gardener recently told me that every year she was learning anew. I heartily agree. Every year we deal with differing circumstances, but we have the same source of wisdom available. All we need to do is ask Him. So let's do a little review. We need to start with cultivated soil, without the weeds and without the grass. We need to make rows for our seed or holes for transplants. This is an example of tiny lettuce seedlings that were grown in their individual containers. The seed was planted into those little cell packs, and as they grew, then they need to be transplanted into those holes. They are watered consistently until they were ready for transplanting. And if you look at that picture carefully, you'll see in the far back, some of the rows, the soil looks light, and in the middle, it's dark. That's showing different types of, or different degrees of moisture in that soil. It should be consistent. This is an example of lettuce plants that are too close. Now with lettuce, you can just let them grow up and cut them off and they'll regrow. But if you wanted to have individual heads, they could be thinned out and those thinnings either transplanted or put in your salad to eat. This is better spacing for lettuce. You can see that they have a little more area to grow. But you can see how large they become in a garden. So that's, again, each of those bunches at the front is one head, and that space between the two sticks is 3 feet. So you can get an idea of how large they can be. These are small tomato seedlings. They're ready to go in. Again, you can see the varying sizes. It could depend on the depth. Maybe I wasn't very careful. Or some seed are more, they're stronger than other seeds. And so we like to, don't depend on the little weak ones, depend on the big strong ones. You can see in this picture within that wooden box that the larger tomatoes, or those tomato seedlings have become much larger. Each of those plants goes into there and then it has the ability to grow up a trellis. But those tomatoes will continue to grow up to the top of that frame and probably sprawl out onto the pathway. So you need to give them lots of space. This is an example of squash and cucumbers that start with a very small seed and then they spread. So in the front of that picture are cucumbers. Standing up behind it is a zucchini plant, and it will branch out even more. That's still mid-season, not late season. So what should we plant? Well, this is a basic list. What types of plants do you need? This basic planting list leaves you room to add your favorite varieties and experiment with all sorts of new plants. If we are serious about growing our food to eat, there are some basic things that we will need. The first would be greens and herbs. So in the second row from the right, you will see some herbs. I can see chamomile and spinach and, oh, I can't tell what that one is. I see some garlic and I know that there will be lettuce in there and etc. You'll need some veggies to eat fresh and preserve, like tomatoes and peppers, peas, beans, cucumbers. What you're seeing basically there are pea plants growing up and lettuce at the base of it. And I just want to comment on that since the picture is there. I can put the lettuce right beside the peas because lettuce will grow quickly and I will harvest it quickly, usually before the peas are ready to harvest. This year I made a mistake and put some onions in front of the peas, and now I have to step over them every time I want to harvest the peas. You'll also need some storage crops for the winter eating. So these are potatoes, squash. In some areas you can store carrots and beets as well. So you want to think about things that can be stored without having to put them into the freezer or into cans or jars. You can grow small fruit bushes or melons. These are small cantaloupe and watermelon, or raspberries, hiding under that netting again, or strawberries. There's a difference between perennial and annual. Plants require planting every year are called annual, which are most of our vegetables. Though plants produce seed if they're allowed to mature, and that seed can be planted again the next season if it's saved properly. Some self-seed and you'll find volunteer plants next season where you had grown it the year before. Plants that will keep coming back year after year are called perennial. Example would be the berries and the bushes, and trees are keep on growing until they don't. There are fruits that grow on trees, such as apples, pears, plums, peaches, etc. They take more explanation than I'm going to give in this session, especially because I don't have enough pictures. I find that I take pictures in the earlier part of the season and then get so busy that I don't take more pictures. So I'm sorry about that. But the principles of growing trees are similar to growing small plants. They need enough room to grow. They need nutrition to feed the plant. And they need to also be pruned to allow for light and air to move through the tree so that there's not fungal diseases, etc. When do you begin planting? Your area will have a last frost date. If you plant cold tolerant plants before, generally they will be okay. If you plant those that aren't cold tolerant, a frost could kill them. So we have a last frost date in the end of May. However, this year I started planting in the house in March for those things that need a longer growing season. And then I planted into the garden in April, and because it was warm, but then we started getting cold again. And you can see how much work it would require to cover those plants night after night after night to keep them from freezing. And that white that you see on the front tarp, that's a blue tarp, and all that white that makes it look light blue is actually frost or ice on them. So it becomes quite a labor of love. You have to take the tarps off every morning because as soon as the sun hits, it would create too much heat for the plant. So it's quite a labor. And every year I tell Frank to remind me to wait until the end of May. But I get the bug and I want to plant early. I like fresh vegetables as soon as possible. Transplants that don't mind the frost can go into the garden early, but they would need to be protected from freezing temperatures and sometimes even just protected from the cold so that it gives them the opportunity to grow faster and better. When they are stressed by cold, they stunt their growth and they don't do as well. And what I find often is that things I put in the garden very early are not much further ahead than what I put in later when it's warm. So take my experience and, well, you'll do your own, but I'm a hard learner sometimes. Wait to plant worm-loving plants until it's warm, until it's consistently warm. Now, things like tomatoes and peppers, cucumbers, squash, they want it consistently warm in the nighttime, not just the day. It's the nighttime temperatures that usually shock a plant. This year, our last frost date was actually the middle of June, which is really late. Rows, beds, trellises, hills. There's a lot of different things shown in this slide. You'll see some square or rectangular trellises. You'll see some shaped trellises. You see rows, you see boxes. So remember that cucumber picture? That was a plant that would have been grown in a small, low hill. There was also a picture of some raised beds back in the cucumber picture. Let's see if I can find it so that you can see it. This is your review. I guess it's too far back. Well, maybe I shouldn't have gone this far. I'm sorry about that. We'll skip forward. Raised beds are like a long row that's raised up, and people like them if they don't want to bend over as far. If they're in moist area, a raised bed allows for better drainage. Here, I don't use raised beds because we have a high water table. And so if I keep things flat, those roots will go down into that water table and I don't have such a problem of watering. Whereas the woman that lived on our property had raised beds and she had to water every day. We use beds, just flat beds, for carrots, beets, lettuce, garlic, and onions. They do not have a large footprint and they tolerate growing close to each other. As they fill out, they'll help each other to stay moist. So you can see some onions from the year before and some thyme at the end, but in between are three very partial carrot rows. They're just starting to come up. And as that season progresses, that will be a full bed of green. You won't see any soil. We use trellises for peas, beans, tomatoes, and sometimes cucumbers. Now, this is a picture of some tomato plants at the very end of the season. I had stripped the leaves off because I wanted the tomatoes to ripen. So this is probably already in September. And our frost date for the fall is usually the middle of September. So one frost would have already happened, which would have killed the foliage. And then they usually get a couple weeks before a lower frost comes, a lower temperature, which would damage fruit. So this is the last attempt to get those things ripe. We use rows for potatoes, beets, lettuce, strawberries, raspberries. Those raspberries, which are the tall row at the back of the picture, they're only one stalk, and there's usually two planted per foot, but they really fill out and then have babies in the summer. So they grow very quickly in width. What about the timing for planting? You can do it one of two ways. You can do it progressively, which is what I do, or you can do it all at once. Because I have a large space, I usually do it progressively. So I do my cool crops first. I'll plant my greens, peas, onions, potatoes at one point. And then as it gets warmer, but warm enough for them to germinate at night, then I can do carrots, beets, and the brassica family. Those plants that need to have warm without risk of frost do not go in until the end of May. So that's beans, tomatoes, peppers, squash, melons, etc. You can extend your growing season by covering earlier in the season to protect from frost. But as I mentioned, that's a lot of work. But you can see in this photo that that's what I did. All those little pieces of tarp and row cover are protecting from another frost. And that's why it looks so fuzzy. It's ice all over the place. You can also extend your season later in the summer. You can do the same by covering with tarps. Or here is an example of planting into cold frames that will have a lid. And so when it gets too cold, the tall plants will be cut down. The lid can be put on it. But again, that lid will have to be opened and closed consistently every morning and evening. It's like babysitting. Or you can do what we call the winter garden. You can do it on a smaller scale. This is a hoop house that we have, and it's a theory that we read about in Elliot Coleman's book, The Four Season Harvest. And I want to explain what you're seeing for a moment. That is a hoop house. It has no heat, and so the soil is inside of the hoop house. Behind, you also see some more cultivated soil. So Frank built this so that it can move. Where it is where it was for the summer and last winter. This fall, planting would be done in the soil behind the hoop house. Cold frames would be placed over those plants, and then the hoop house would be moved over top of it, and it would remain in the back section for the winter and next summer. I hope that's not too hard to understand. You can read more about it in Elliot Coleman's book. We like to grow the summer garden and then the winter garden. So I start by planting cold tolerant crops in August in those cold frames. So that would be things like oak leaf lettuce. Something that is prolific is Claytonia or miner's lettuce. It doesn't even like to germinate when it's warm, and it will self-seed and it will just grow like a mat of green. These plants will mature by October, and then they'll just maintain through the winter, at least in our climate. You'd have to experiment in yours. And I think Elliot has a list of things that we'll do in the different temperature zones. So it looks small. There's usually 4 to 6 cold frames. He figures 1 cold frame per person in the family, and it fills up, and then you have fresh food to eat all winter. Now, I experiment with other crops as well. So crops can be covered either by plastic covered lids on the cold frames or glass over boxes or hoops with plastic. So I've already mentioned that the hoop house has cold frames in it, and then the hoop house itself is covered with greenhouse as well, or greenhouse plastic. So apparently every layer of protection is like 1 temperature zone south. So it keeps the roots from freezing, even though the leaves may freeze. Inside this year, I planted a little crop of beets and greens and parsley, and I even did some peas and cherry tomatoes just to see if they would grow. Now these are very close together, but they weren't going to stay there. They were harvested shortly after this picture. These are lettuce seedlings in the hoop house. This is lettuce in November inside. So these are heads or bunches. This is in November of that year. So you can see that I have squash that was harvested and still is doing a little more curing. Herbs are in the pots. There is kale that is just about 8 inches tall. It will grow to 1 foot or 2 feet tall. There's lettuce in all those cold frames, especially as you get further to the back of the hoop house. So we would cut and eat and cut and eat and cut and eat. This is an example of the winter of that same hoop house, but inside is lunch. We don't go in when it's really, really cold, like minus 20. Around the freezing mark, we will still go in there and open up, but not when it's too cold. And we are blessed to have fresh food all winter. There's 3 reasons we like to do the hoop house. 1 is I don't have to do as much in the summer garden because I have fresh food during the winter. 2, we get the fresh food all year. And 3, it eliminates as much preserving. Now, you can't always depend on the winter garden. What happens if some disaster happened that your food all froze? So you need to have what you need and then plant extra to have fresh. Now, this is a picture of it in March. It's time to start planting again. But if you look, we cut and ate from all those cold frames all winter, and yet there's still lots of greens, and we can never keep up on it. When people come, I'm constantly giving greens away in April and May, and yes, just trying to use it. And then when that doesn't work, we just cut it and use it for mulch. So what about harvesting? It's not enough to just grow food and let it be in your garden and have it look nice. The purpose is to harvest it and to be able to use it. Some food should be cut, like lettuce or spinach, and then they will regrow for more salad. If you pluck it up by the roots, which you can do if you want to give it to someone, or if you don't want it to grow there anymore, then it will not regrow. Root vegetables like carrots or potatoes, beets can be dug with a spade or a potato fork. Peas, beans are picked as they mature for a few weeks. I have a friend who once picked peas, just the first ones that were ready, and then pulled the plants, meaning that she lost a few more weeks of harvest. because they are progressive. A little bit comes at a time, so we're not overwhelmed with it all. So it's always best to ask someone with experience to guide you in the process of knowing when things are really ready and when to pick them, how to pick them. You need to be gentle when you harvest. If you're picking peas or beans or cucumbers, it's good to hold the plant and then to be able to pull the bean off. If you just pull the bean or the pea without stabilizing the main plant, you can pull the plant out by the roots and then you lose its growth. It's also important, besides giving your garden watering and weeding and making sure it's got nutrition, you need to watch for insects. There is always the potential of insects coming in to damage your garden. So like I mentioned earlier, you want to make sure that those plants are as healthy as possible, but realize that potatoes attract potato beetles and that beans and cucumbers can attract another little insect. There's beetles that will attack squash blossoms. So you need to recognize the symptoms of attack and also the critters that do the attacking and know what to do about them. With many things, it's hand picking. And if you're anything like me, that is not something pleasant. So I always wear gloves, and you can pick them off and put them into a little pail that has some water so that they don't fly out or crawl out. And then you can discard them when they're dead. It's a terrible thing, but we have to fight against that, which is fighting against our food source. We need to remember when you harvest to wash your produce well, especially if you've used manure in your garden, and then you can enjoy it. Now, there's not manure, let's say, on your upper growth things, but if there's been birds sitting on trellises or flying over top, you want to make sure that the produce is clean so you're not ingesting something that you don't want. There is nothing like fresh vegetables and fruit from your own garden plot. Once you have tasted the difference, you will not want to go back to the store-bought produce. There is a sweetness because of the extra nutrition, and that is a blessing from God. And we can so be so thankful and praise Him for what He gives us. You can even do some family menu planning and make up some creations and enjoy them. This is one of Frank's creations. It's strawberries with tahini and honey on homemade bread. Usually he adds coconut to make it look really nice. But you can just find the pleasure and the joy in seeing the miracle of each thing that is produced from that tiny, tiny seed. It is truly the blessing of God. Now, what about spiritual fruit bearing? Because we don't want to just have a physical experience here. Matthew 7, 16 to 21 gives us a solemn warning and also a promise. You shall know them by their fruits. Do men gather grapes of thorns or figs of thistles? Even so, every good tree that bringeth forth good fruit, but a corrupt tree bringeth forth evil fruit. A good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit, neither can a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. Every tree that brings not forth good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire. Wherefore, by their fruits ye shall know them. Not everyone that says unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. The principle spiritually is also the principle physically. If you have plants growing that do not bear fruit and they're past their time of being able to bear fruit, you might as well pluck them out. They're just taking up real estate and moisture and nutrition. I had a row of 25 feet of pepper plants years ago that was planted in an area that had been grass. And it had been tilled up, and I put in the plants, and I've never seen such healthy pepper plants. They were taller than usual, wider than usual, full of leaves, deep green, looked beautiful, but they never produced a pepper because they were missing the element in the soil that was going to help produce fruit. In fact, they had too much of one element, the nitrogen from all that grass breaking down. So in our soil, we need the right balance. In our lives, we need the right balance. We can be very showy and pretentious, like those pretentious pepper plants, but never bear fruit. And that's what God wants us to do, to be able to bear fruit. From the book, Christ Object Lessons, there can be no growth or fruitfulness in the life that is centered in self. If you have accepted Christ as a personal savior, you are to forget yourself and try to help others. Talk of the love of Christ, tell of his goodness, do every duty that presents itself. Carry the burden of souls upon your heart, and by every means in your power, seek to save the lost. As you receive the Spirit of Christ, the Spirit of unselfish love and labor for others, you will grow and bring forth fruit. The graces of the Spirit will ripen in your character. Your faith will increase, your convictions deepen, your love be made perfect. More and more, you will reflect the likeness of Christ in all that is pure, noble, and lovely. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. This fruit can never perish, but will produce after its kind a harvest unto eternal life. When the fruit is brought forth, immediately he put it in the sickle, because the harvest is come. Christ is waiting with longing desire for the manifestation of himself in his church. When the character of Christ shall be perfectly reproduced in his people, then he will come to claim them as his own. It is the privilege of every Christian not only to look for, but to hasten the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Were all who profess his name bearing fruit to his glory, how quickly the whole world would be sown with the seed of the gospel. Quickly the last harvest would be ripened, and Christ would come to gather the precious grain. It's about growing and bearing fruit to the glory of God. It's about developing characters that are like Jesus. And there's a promise in Psalm 126, verse 5 and 6. They that sow in tears shall reap in joy. He that goeth forth and weepeth, bearing precious seed, shall doubtless come again with rejoicing, bringing his sheaves with him. That tells me that planting seed is not always going to be a happy thing. Working for a harvest is not always going to be easy, but God promises joy and a reward for those who will be faithful in doing what his will is. I pray that as he that ministers seed to the sower will both minister bread for your food and multiply your seed sown and increase the fruits of your righteousness, that you being enriched in everything to all bountifulness, which causeth through us thanksgiving to God. May God bless you in your gardening, both for the vegetables and fruit, and in your heart gardening, that you may bear fruit to the glory of God. I hope and pray this has been helpful to you, and that one day I'll hear about your gardening ventures. Thank you, and God bless you. Bye-bye.
We hope that you've learned a lot from this presentation, and we also hope that you'll be able to put all these things into practice. Before we close, we'd like for you to please join us in a prayer. Our precious Father, we thank you once again for this message that we heard, and thank you for all the instructions that we received from you. We ask you to please bless us so that we may put these things into practice, and that we may be able to live in the country and be able to produce our own fruits and everything that we can where we're going to send us. Guide us and also bless the sister presented the topic, and may you help us so that we may take these things at heart and practice them in our lives. Bless all the rest of the program that is going to continue till Wednesday. We ask you also to bless all those who are going to be watching. We pray you, we ask you all these things in the name and merits of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Well, thank you all for being with us today, and thank you for watching. We hope to see you tomorrow at 7:30 p.m., where we're going to continue with another topic. May God bless you, and may His grace be with you. Amen.